On today's episode, we have a rather enlightening project.
Welcome back to Matt's Basement Workshop, sponsored by
Microjig, maker of the Gripper. Work safer, work smarter.
Hey everybody, welcome back to Matt's Basement Workshop. So as we're recording this, it is the beginning of winter, which means the days are shorter, the nights are longer, and depending on where you're located, it's probably getting a little cold. It definitely is here in Michigan, so we may have the furnace kick on at some point, but it shouldn't get in the way as we're going through what we're going to be doing today. And what we're doing today is creating this really great lamp, or in this case, it's actually just a lamp shade. We haven't put the light in it yet. Now, perhaps you saw the picture where I had originally constructed this, and it is a really great accent light. It's definitely not one that is going to be filling the room with tons of amazing light. There are a couple of different ways that we can attach the light. I'm going to show you the most basic way to do it, which is really super simple. So that way we can focus all of our attention on the construction of this. And to be quite honest with you, it really won't take very long. You can complicate this all sorts of different ways, but I think the hardest part about it is maybe coming up with a design like I have here. When we turn as you can see in the picture here, when the light is on, you can notice like this really neat zigzag pattern in here. And we're going to duplicate that again just because I really enjoy it. I think it's kind of fun. But anyways, though, let's go ahead and get started first talking about the material itself. So the lampshade itself is just a cherry veneer, and it happens to be a paper-backed cherry veneer. Now, again, the folks over at Oakwood Veneers sent this to me a while ago, and I think they were hoping I was going to make maybe more some flat work out of it or something, or incorporate it into a much bigger project. But when that inspiration hit me, I'm like, this is absolutely perfect. And the nice thing about this paperback veneer is, as you can see, you can kind of roll it up nice and tight, and you're not going to worry about the veneer cracking and splitting on you. I was playing with some of the store-bought veneers, like ones I picked up at, say, Woodcraft or Rockler, and the problem was maybe they'd just been sitting around too long, maybe I need to soak them or something, but they don't really bend very easily without cracking, and of course, it also could depend on the species itself. But anyways, though, this one works out really, really great, and the neat thing about this paperback veneer is just the fact that, like I said, it holds up really strong, and it gives you the extra strength to kind of bend it. Now, the fun thing about this is we can make this any size we want to. We can make it for an existing lamp, or we can just make all brand new ones like we're going to end up doing today. But really what it comes down to is figuring out what size you need right here. So I'm just going to go ahead and open this up. And right now, I happen to have this at 42 inches in length, and it's about 16 inches in depth. So it makes for a pretty good size lamp, but this time around what I want to do is I want to make one that's actually probably about half that size. So of course we're going to do about 21 inches, and we'll make it about 10 inches deep. So we're going to make a couple of those, in fact. So let's go ahead and let's set this aside where it's not going to get damaged, hopefully. Let's grab our existing veneer right here. And again, this is that beautiful cherry that we have. And we're probably gonna need some clamps in here to help hold things in place. So let me go ahead and just grab this to kind of keep this in position for us. And let's see, we said that it was gonna be approximately 10 inches deep. So we're gonna go this way. And like I mentioned, well, you know what? Let's just go ahead and we'll mark for two of them. All right, so there's 20 inches. And we said we're going to do 21 inches total that way. So again, let's just turn this real quick. And to be quite honest with you, my original cut on this, when I made that first one, I kind of got a little sloppy, so it's not the greatest cut in the world, but to be honest, it's not that big a deal. I really don't have a problem with it being a little off. But at the same time, if you really want it to be very, very straight and maybe symmetrical or something, take your time and make sure you get those cuts really good. So we said 21 inches here and 21 inches here. And let's just go ahead and mark those lines. And then we're going to come back in with a knife and cut them. All go. There's one. All right, so we have one, two. Oh, we actually happen to have a third one. Turned out there was just enough material left over from the veneer that I'm like, you know what, let's just make a trio of these. That'd be pretty fun. It gives us a chance to kind of just get more experience with it. So the next thing I want to do is I want to talk about creating that seam. And as you can see in the picture, we have a very strong zigzag seam in the first one. In fact, let me go ahead and just grab this. Now, that strong zigzag seam comes from the fact that we created both of a zigzag pattern on both sides. You don't have to do this. I did discover when I was playing around with it that if I just simply did one pattern on one side, it would show through. But I don't know, and at this point, I really don't care if I were to do this. I'm just going to continue doing this because it's kind of a fun pattern, and like I said, I get a really strong line on it. The main thing is just to make sure that they overlap each other an equal amount so that it will show up with that really strong line on there. But anyways, you can kind of play around with those. So that's what we're going to do, is we're going to continue with this one, doing that zigzag. You don't even have to do a pattern. You could just overlap it just a little bit so that you have just a single line going straight down. That would actually be pretty cool. In fact, we'll do that with just one of these, just to give the comparison, but with the other two, we're definitely going to do the zigzag. So let's go ahead and work on that now. Let's lay out that zigzag pattern and cut those out. Okay, so the first thing we're going to do is define how much of that overlap. So we're going to go approximately 1 inch. And this is going to be, we're going to measure it on both ends. So there's 1 inch. And then now, this really wants to roll up on us, but oh well, we're just going to go ahead and let's lightly draw that line. This is going to be our base for our peaks and our valleys. So let's do this. We know that this is 10 inches. And what I was thinking is we'll just do like a peak every other inch. So we'll go, let's get this right here near the edge. So the first one is here at 1, and then 3, 5, 7, 9. And then what that does is over here on this side, we'll then go 2, 4, 6, 8, and then we'll start connecting these lines, and you'll see everything start to form. We'll have to do the opposite at the other end so that it gives us like that look like they're trying to mate up with each other, and that will give us that really strong zigzag pattern when the light is on. So I'll go ahead and finish this up, and we'll come back and cut these out. So as you can see, we've got our lines drawn out, and I went so far as to put X's in the locations that I want to remove it. And now we're just going to start cutting the pieces free, making sure that we push down hard enough. And I like to pull away so that I'm not cutting into the body. So, all right, so that one feels like it's free. Let's just do this. Let's keep going in this direction so that we can get a good look at this. And then now, let's come in this way, and let's cut these first couple away. Sorry if my hand kind of blocks the angle here. The main thing is trying not to damage those tips. All right, so this one should be all set. And if you do this the right way, these little cutoffs, actually you could probably use them for something else. I got myself lined up here, I'm trying to look over the camera, so, all right, let's see, there we go, carefully, and we'll just continue this, and once we're done, we'll show you how to put it together. So what we need to do now is we've got everything cut to the shapes, and we're just going to go ahead and glue them up. Now, this is simple as applying. In this case, I'm going to use some CA glue just because makes it move a lot faster, and it holds up really nice, and I haven't had any issues with it. So we'll go ahead and apply this right here on one side. And those baselines that we drew are going to be my reference point for how we match these up. I think I mentioned that before. So again, we have those baselines in here. And as I bring this together, I know the one that I just glued, put all the glue on, that's going to be the top. So I just kind of eyeball it. And all right, there's the top part put together. Let's go ahead and I'm just going to clamp this in position while we move these things around. There we go. So this is all glued up. And we're just going to set it aside. Wait for it to dry like we did these other ones. The main thing is just finding a way to set it so that it, I'm gonna hold on to it for a few minutes. Anyways, while this is setting up, then we can get ready to do the next part. So on the inside of the lampshade, I have these cross beams, which are gonna, one, add some rigidity to the lampshade, and then two, this will be what we end up hanging the light from. Really simple to make. We just ended up using some scrap material. We cut it to length, and then we created this notch just by kind of ganging them up once we figured out exactly where approximately the center was. It's okay if these are a little loose. I'm not too worried about it. Once we get it in place, they'll be nice and tight and not going anywhere. Once we had that done, we then took them and made sure that they were inverted, because if we had them both going in the same way, this next step wouldn't work for us. So we want to make sure that we have one inverted on the other. And then we ended up creating these notches here on the end. Again, just using the carcass saw, we ganged them up, cut the notch, not all the way down, of course, came back in with a chisel, cleared it out. If you were a patron of Matt's Basement Workshop, I would be going into a little bit more detail about this, but what you just saw is really the basic steps for how to do this. So once we have everything half-lapped, we have our notches made, we then are pretty much done. We just need to drill some holes, as you can see in the shade itself. And the easiest way to find that is, again, we're going to use our half lap notch support beams, whatever we want to call these things. We're going to use these to help us locate it. So what I've actually done here, as you can see, I've put this in place, and I don't want to have a hole right there where the seam is. I kind of want to have it just off to the side. So I'm just going to use these. I'll just move them around until I find right where I want it, which seems to be right about here. So then I'm going to take a pencil, and I'll do the ones back here. I'll mark their approximate location. And then once I have those, I'm going to come back in, and I'm going to measure down about 1 inch, and I'll drill the hole. In this case, we're going to drill about a 3/8 inch hole. I just moved that once. Let's double check it. Yep, that's good. All right, so we'll remove these. Come in, and again, we're going to come down about 1 inch. I'll mark these, and then we'll be ready to drill. Now, to drill these, we want to make sure that the veneer doesn't split, so I went ahead and I set up this little jig here. That's what we want to call it. And I have another board that has a hole pre-drilled in it to the right diameter bit, and I'm just going to place this right over, approximately center my mark, and come in, press down firmly, there we go, and it gives me a nice tear-free hole. So we'll just go ahead and repeat it for the other three remaining holes. So with everything all set here, let's go ahead and we'll insert the bottom half lap first. Carefully getting it to fit through the hole. It might be a little bit of a snug fit. Just don't tear it. Right. There we go. Part of the reason for that notching is then when these fit in, if they're just a little bit loose, they grab the material and pull it in on itself. All right, so this first one, now that's through, and then now we'll carefully drop this down so that it's mating with its half lap. It's going to poke through the hole, and there we go. All right, so here she is. She looks fantastic. This is probably the best light I've ever been in for the podcast. But she looks absolutely amazing. Of course, we have the other two to finish up here. Unfortunately, I only have one of these hanging lights to work with for right now. But again, I mentioned this. Look at the zigzag pattern. It's really strong because of the fact that we made the matching ends there to kind of overlap with one another. But it looks absolutely beautiful. So again, let me turn on the overhead lights and let's wrap up this episode. And that's all there really is to creating this lampshade. A fun little project, and again, you can vary it with all sorts of different veneers. I actually have some Douglas fir veneer, that again, from the folks over at Oakwood Veneers. It's the same as this one. It has the paper back to it. I think that's going to look absolutely gorgeous. And with the lighter color of the wood, I think the light inside is really going to show through this. One thing I should mention, and I kind of alluded to this a little bit, the way that I ended up hanging the light in here is I ended up getting some of these screw hooks, just a real simple one, and I'll try and bring this in to show you what I have here. I ended up putting one on top, one on bottom, and I bent them so that they got a little bit of a crook to it. And what ends up happening is I can feed the wire down through the top one and the bottom one, and they center it, number one, in the very center of the lampshade, but number two, they hold it in place so that I can hang this pretty much anywhere and I don't have to worry about, you know, it falling down or anything else. Originally, I was tying this around the support beam. Sometimes it would center the light, sometimes it wouldn't, but I think this is just such an easier alternative. Anyways, if you have comments, questions, suggestions, I love hearing from all of you. You can email me at mattsbasementworkshop@gmail.com. You can drop me a line over at the website at mattsbasementworkshop.com, where you can leave a comment in the show notes for today's episode. And you can do the same thing over at YouTube if that happens to be where you're watching this. So until the next time, I will be talking to you soon. Straight grains and sharp blades.
Thanks for watching. For more information on topics discussed in this episode, visit mattsbasementworkshop.com. Also, please consider becoming a patron of Matt's Basement Workshop. Get early access to new shows, bonus content from each episode, and so much more. Visit patreon.com/Matt's Basement Workshop to sign up and start receiving your benefits today.